Let's talk with Clohawk. I chat, I sing, I have lots of fun. I will talk to anyone. Let's talk with Clohawk. That's me!
Hello and welcome back to my show. I'm Albert Clohawk and I'm joined by a very, very, very special guest. I'm really excited she's here. This lady is an award-winning actress. She's also an author and a wildlife campaigner whose work is inspiring. She's even had an OBE. I can't believe how lucky I am to have her on my show. Please welcome my super amazing guest, Virginia McKenna.
Hello, Albert. Thanks so much for having me on your show.
Thanks, Virginia. I'm so excited that you're on my show.
Well, that's very kind, Albert. I'm happy to be spending some time with you.
If it's okay, I'm going to dive straight in with my questions.
Sure, that's fine.
Okay, you started your career as an actress. Did you want to be an actress when you were growing up?
I didn't think of it quite like that. I loved acting in the school plays, and then when I left school, I auditioned for the Old Vic Drama School and failed to get in, and then I auditioned for another school.
You went to Royal Central, the drama school in London. That's where my daddy went. Did you have a good time there?
It ticked every box. I had a wonderful time there and made some very long-lasting friends. One I'm still in touch with to this very day.
What was your first professional acting role?
I'd been at the Central for 2 years, and then an agent saw me in something and got me a job in the summer holidays with the Dundee Repertory Theatre in Scotland. So I went up there for 2 plays, and I never went back to school. I stayed on, and I was there for 6 months.
How did you get the role in the film Born Free?
My husband Bill Travers and I were asked to play the Adamsons in the film Born Free, taken from Joy Adamson's amazing book. And I think they asked us because we were married, we had 3 children, and we were established couple, as it were, that because it was quite a complicated story to tell and nobody quite knew how to do it in a way, I'm sure you'll understand that working with lions is quite different from working with other actors. And so I think they felt having a married couple might pose fewer problems, or no problems at all, hopefully, than 2 people who didn't know each other at all suddenly faced working with lions.
To be nice making a film with your husband and having your children there too. What was it like on the film set?
We filmed the whole film in Kenya, and there actually wasn't a film set. It wasn't quite like being in, well, not at all like being in a studio where, you know, the technicians are getting ready, not that they didn't on location of course as well, but not in a set. It was a real life house that we worked in, real life wild, real life beach at the coast. Everything was natural because it was about wild animals and nature, really. And this extraordinary relationship between this particular lion, lioness, Elsa, and the Adamsons.
Were you scared of the lions when you first saw them? I think I would have been. They have big teeth and big claws and they're really powerful.
Well, you're quite right in a way about being nervous of the lions that we first met. The first 2 lions that we were introduced to were actually ex-circus lions. They were not small, they were quite large and they weren't young. One was 10 and one was 9. And when we went into the compound with the trainer, we had a circus trainer to teach us we had to hold little sticks in our hands, which we held in a certain position that the lions understood. If we did this, it meant we wanted the lioness to go that way or that way. Anyway, I'm sure you understand what I'm saying. But we used to drive home every evening quite silently for a while because we thought, how can we tell this story, which is a love story between two people and a learner's, when we can only behave when the trainer says we can, in a way. There was one day when my husband went in for his training session, and Astra, the particular learner he was going to be with that morning, was in a really, really bad mood. And he felt very nervous. She tried to get at him, and the trainer, Monica, had to put herself between the learners and him. Unfortunately, there was only one door out of the compound that he was working in, so he had no choice of escape, just that one door, one gate. Luckily, he managed to get out, and the people watching, the producers and one or two other people, were ashened. They were really worried because they thought their leading man was about to be jumped on by a learner's, and they immediately withdrew both the learnesses from any contact work, and then we had none. What happened then was that they were searching crazily, really, to find some other lions of all ages. We had, of course, little lions, bigger lions, and even bigger lions. Mainly lionesses, but some lions too. And very luckily, they found that the Scots Guards Regiment in Nairobi had two mascots, a lion and a lioness, brother and sister, and they were called Boy and Girl. And these two animals had been rescued as cubs. They'd been abandoned for some reason, I never knew why. And they became the charges of a wonderful man called Sergeant Rives. And when the producers discovered these two lions, they asked if they could use them in the film, buy them virtually. And it was agreed. So Sergeant Rives brought these two young animals up country to us where we were on location. Fortunately, the person in charge of all the animal work with us, the two humans, was the real George Adamson, who, with his wife Joy, of course, had the real Elsa. So this was an absolute gift to us, certainly, and to the film, I do believe. I think without George, it would not have been the same film.
Did you know how successful the film was going to be and how your life was going to change?
We didn't realise that at the time. It was only at the end that something happened that did change our life, actually. Without our knowing, tragically, most of the lands had already been sold to zoos and safari parks in different countries by the film company. But we managed to save three: Boy, Girl, and a wonderful male called Ugus, fully grown male. And he'd come from the animal orphanage in Nairobi, where he was sent back after filming was over. And we managed, I can't remember quite how, we managed to get Ugus to join Boy and Girl. And Boy and Girl were given to George, and George Adamson set up his little camp, very primitive little camp, in a park, a game reserve, as they were called in those days, national parks now, but game reserve then, called Meru. He set up his little camp below a hill called Elsa's Kopje, and he taught, as only George could, these three lions to be really wild again, hunting their own food and all the rest of it. So that's where the next part of the story began, because my husband Bill decided he wanted to make a documentary film of what George was doing. And he made his first documentary film called The Lions Are Free.
I watched The Born Free last week with my daddy. I loved it. I can't believe it was made so long ago. Have you suddenly watched it recently?
Well, I'm glad you watched Born Free a little while ago. No, I haven't watched it for many, many years. In fact, I hardly ever watch films that I've been in. I don't particularly enjoy watching myself, so I rather watch other people. And I love watching documentary wildlife films.
After the film, you created the Born Free Foundation. Can you tell me how that started?
It was some years after that all this happened that something else came, another animal actually, came into our life, a little elephant. She was called Poli Poli, which means slowly, slowly in Swahili. And she had been caught from her family in the wild, she was only about 2 years old, as a gift by the then government of the time of Kenya to London Zoo. And we were going to film in a park called Tsavo, which is in the east, towards the east of Kenya. So we went down there and we set up our camp, and a very famous couple called David and Daphne Sheldrick, who rescued orphaned elephants and had two teenage elephants that they were going to return to the wild. We told David Sheldrick, told both of them really, David and Daphne, about this little elephant and what we needed. And David said, look, I tell you what we'll do. You two and I, that's David speaking, will come to Nairobi, go to Nairobi and see this little elephant. And so we did that. And we went to the trapper's compound and we found this terrified little elephant rushing up and down the pen she was in, stockade she was in. Literally, she was so frightened. And my heart sank. I said to David, well, we'll never be able to work with her because she's so terrified, poor thing. And David said, well, if I can have her with me for 2 days, I think I can calm her, reassure her, probably introduce her to the other elephants that we have, and I think it'll be fine. So we were allowed to do that. She came up to Tsavo, and David succeeded exactly as he'd said. She loved the other two elephants, she became a part of their little family group, and she was truly the star of the film. What happened next was different. When we finished filming, we asked if we could buy her and give her to Daphne and David so that she could go back to the wild one day with her companions. And the government said, yes, of course, that will be perfectly fine. We'll sell her to you. But, they said, we'll have to capture another. Well, I don't think I need to tell you what that would have meant. Another little elephant torn from the family it loved and depended on to go to captivity. It was one of the worst decisions I think we ever had to make. But we said we can't do that. So she came to London Zoo. I was rather a coward and I couldn't bear to go and see her at the zoo, so I didn't for a long time. And then we heard that she might be destroyed because she'd become rather difficult. So we did go to see her with a journalist. And the moment the keeper saw us coming, they took her inside and shut the door so we couldn't see her. So we left, but we went back. And the next time we went, they didn't see us coming. And we called her. She was pacing up and down, up and down, up and down at the back, up and down. She had one broken little tusk and none on the other side. She stopped walking immediately. She came to us and she put out her trunk to us to greet us. She'd not forgotten us. You know, they say an elephant never forgets, and I absolutely believe that. Unfortunately, although I'd found a place in South Africa, because I was determined to get her out of the zoo, I found a place in South Africa, a reserve that would like to have her. I found someone who would take her and introduce her to the elephants and stay with her till she was settled. Unfortunately, tragically again, the zoo wouldn't agree, but they did say they would send her to their country zoo called Whipsnade, where at least she'd have companion elephants. Unfortunately, that never happened either, because they kept her standing in her travelling crate for so many hours that she collapsed. I have a photograph of someone in the army with a jack, jacking her up onto her feet. Anyway, she got up on her feet eventually. They took her inside. They anaesthetized her, tranquilized her, and examined her. And then we were told she'd lost the will to live. And so they put her down. And it was her death. It wasn't a lion. Although the lion was the seed that was sown, it was her death that began our charity. In those days called ZooCheck, not the Born Free Foundation. Because ZooCheck had a very specific reason for its name. We wanted to check captivity that animals are kept in. How good, how bad, how indifferent, how tragic. And in fact, it was a parcel of all these things together, as we discovered over the years.
Were you interested in wildlife when you were my age?
I was always very interested in wild animals from an early age, because although I wouldn't have condoned it now, but my father was also very interested in animals. But as we lived in a maisonette, which is in a house with two floors, on the bottom floor, which was where the garden was, in his downstairs area, he did have some wild animals. He had a parrot in a cage called Laura. He had a snake called George. And the snake was very passive and used to go for a wriggle in the garden. And I used to go with George, for I didn't wriggle, but I accompanied him. And I don't know what it was that about my father. I think it was a need of his to be associated with animals, but of course not the way that I really believe in. He used to take me to London Zoo, and that why I don't feel afraid of snakes is because he had a friend in the reptile house who was the snake keeper, and we used to go and visit him. I must have been about seven, and they used to put the snakes around my neck, and I thought that was lovely. You know, I didn't know anything about things really at all at that age. But what I never did forget, which wasn't so positive, was when we went into the lion house, because they had no outdoor area in those far-off days. You opened this heavy metal door and clanged it behind you. I can hear it now. And then you saw this row, four or five cages, I can't remember how many now, so long ago, but concrete cages with these magnificent, huge lions pacing up and down and up and down for the rest of their lives. And the clang of the other door through which you left, that sound of the clang and the visual memory of those animals has never left me. And then, when I was nine and was evacuated to South Africa for the war, a friend of mine at school, a year later, said they were going to go on safari to a park, and would I like to come? They were going for a few days. I said, oh, I'd love to come, thank you. So we went to the park. I think it was the Kruger National Park. And there I saw, for the first time, and I can remember that also to this day, a group of about three lions resting under a tree. And I thought, that's it. That's how lions should be, not in a concrete cage in captivity. So it's these two totally different images which I think has made me so passionate about the work we do at Born Free.
With the Born Free Foundation, is it mainly lions you rescue? Or do you help other animals as well?
Now, I may have to answer that question, I may have to look at my notes, because you ask if lions are the only animals we rescue, or do we rescue other animals? And I have a little list here, which I must read to you. Leopards, cheetah, tortoises, hyenas, birds, lions, of course, and primates, monkeys.
Are any of the animals you rescued released back into the wild?
Releasing captive animals back to the wild is very difficult, particularly if they're hunters, predators. They catch other animals to survive. So releasing lions back to the wild and tigers and leopards is very tricky, very rare. That's why I think we have more in our sanctuaries than actually, we don't really release them into the wild. We try to save them where they are rather than to have to put them in a sanctuary. We like to save them in their natural environment. That's where they deserve to be. Some of the animals in Ethiopia we have been able to release back to the wild. Birds, for example, and some primates, some monkeys. So when we can, we do. But we're very, very careful about that.
How's the coronavirus affected the foundation at all?
That's a good question, actually, and I think it affects many charities. The pandemic, which we've all been experiencing over the last, over a year and a half now, isn't it, has made a difference to the donations to charities, because there are so many animal charities, particularly. There are so many people who are suffering and are desperate for help. So it has reduced, and we've had to cut back on quite a lot of things. And I think it's been a wise decision. We've cut back on travel. In fact, we have done virtually no travel for about a year now or more. We've got wonderful teams in Ethiopia and Shamwari who we trust 100%. And now we have Zoom, and we have other ways on the television of seeing and talking to each other, having meetings with each other. It hasn't become quite so critical. So we have had to scale down in other ways too. We've left our office, our rather larger office that we used to have. We are still virtually all working from home, and we have a very small office with just four small meeting rooms and a kitchen in a town called Horsham, which isn't far from where my son Will and I live, and many other people in the foundation. We're all quite near, or most of us are quite near, and so we can go for meetings. And that's proving to be really good, actually. So we haven't missed the big office, and we still feel, I think, connected in the way we always have been together. And we've got some wonderful people working with Born Free. We're very lucky.
Have you noticed any changes over recent years due to climate change?
You're quite right. There has been a lot of weather changes in the world recently. The terrible fires in Australia, droughts. It's heartbreaking when you see, as recently I have been watching some of the fires in Australia, when you think what that is destroying, the wildlife habitat of so many creatures, and our goodness only knows if they can ever, well, it won't in the short term be restored. Let's hope that it will one day be restored. But people have had to leave their homes, family homes, over many years. It's no respecter of species, weather. It affects all of us. Flooding, fires, drought. We all are victims of those things.
I imagine you travel the whole wide world. Do you have a favourite place to go?
I'm afraid my answer to this question is going to be rather obvious, because my favourite places to travel are Africa, is Africa actually, Kenya and South Africa, because I like to go to our sanctuaries and to go to Meru, which is where the story of Elsa the Lioness began, where she's buried, where in the old days I used to take small groups on safari to visit her grave, where George Adamson began his work with lands. So East Africa, Meru and Kora, where the wonderful George Adamson did all his rescue work, there are my favourite places.
Where do you go to be relaxed and have holidays?
Well, I'm not going to say an obvious answer to this question about where do I go on holiday to relax, because actually, because I used to travel so much, I don't feel this urge to go on holiday. I suppose if I would choose a country to go to, apart from Kenya, of course, and South Africa to see our wonderful sanctuaries and our animals, I would say Italy. But now I'm happy to look around me here. I live in a beautiful part of the south of England, and I see trees, I see birds, I see the distant hills, and I don't need to travel anymore.
Sadly, it's getting to the end of our time together, but we've got time for our quick fire questions. Answer these as fast as you can. Are you ready?
Oh, your quick fire questions. I'm trying to be ready, but it's going to be quite a challenge, I have to say. Start.
What is your favourite animal?
Well, I'm starting by saying it's impossible to tell you because I love them all. I don't have favourite animals. They're all different, they're all special, and I love them all.
What is your favourite food?
My favourite food, vegetarian or vegan?
What is your favourite TV show?
My favourite TV show are travel shows and documentaries about wildlife.
Who is your favourite author?
Laurie Lee, who wrote Cider with Rosie. Lauren St. John, who's a fantastic writer for young people. I suggest your father gets you some copies of her books. They are brilliant. And a wonderful, wonderful author, very famous, called Michael Morpurgo. He also writes books for young people, and he's also, well, Lauren and Michael are both close personal friends as well.
Thanks, Virginia. I felt like I've really got to know you for the last few minutes. Do you have any questions you want to ask me?
Yes, I do have a question for you. When did you decide that you wanted to become an interviewer? Were you inspired by someone? Do let me know.
Well, Virginia, I love talking and I love meeting new people and hearing all about them. Also, I want to be famous one day, really famous like you. If it's okay, I have one final question to ask you before you go. What advice would you offer me to have a career like you and maybe work for the Born Free Foundation?
I would advise you to volunteer with some very good theatrical groups. I'd learn a skill somehow involved with filmmaking. You could go to university, but that's not essential. I tell you what is, follow your heart.
Thanks, Virginia. I've got a lot to think about now. I will follow my heart. That's what my daddy says. Thanks, Virginia, for talking to me today. I absolutely loved it. My daddy sends his love, and he thanks you for being in his book.
It was really wonderful to have been invited by him to be a part of his book. And please, give him my love.
Bye, Virginia. Take care and keep safe. Well, that's it for the series. Make sure you subscribe to my channel so you don't miss any future videos. But for now, that's me, Albert Clohawk, over and out.
Born free, as free as the wind. The grass grows, born free to follow your heart.